95 together in your hymnal, 395. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. Let's all stand together as we turn to 395. In my heart there rings a melody.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody in heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love.
Singing this morning. Good to see you in church today. A beautiful fall day, isn't it? And glad you got up and came to church. And good singing to start us off. Let's open with a word of prayer together, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for another Lord's Day that you've blessed us with. And thank you for each one who's made their way to come to church this morning. And Lord, we believe that not only are we here, we believe that you're here as well. You said whenever we gather together that there you'll be in the midst. And so, Lord, we pray that you'll be pleased with our service here this morning. You'll use the music and our fellowship together, the preaching of your word, Lord, to mold us and to shape us and to make us more like Christ. So may you have your way in each aspect of our service. And, Lord, I pray that each of us would have ears to hear what the Spirit would say to us today in this service. Use it in each one of our hearts and lives, please. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
We're part of a family that's been born again. Part of Jesus has saved us and made us his own. Now we're part of the family that's on his way home. And sometimes we laugh together, sometimes we cry, sometimes we share together. Sometimes we dream together of how it will be when we all get to heaven, God's family.
When a brother meets sorrow,
we all feel his grief.
When he's passed through the valley,
we all feel relief. Together in sunshine, together in rain, together in victory, through his precious name. And sometimes we laugh together, sometimes times we share together heartaches and sighs. Sometimes we dream together of how it will be when we all get to heaven, God's family. And though some go before us, sometimes we laugh together, sometimes we cry, sometimes we share together heartaches and sighs, sometimes we dream together of how it will be when we all get to
turn with me to number 311, 311, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. 311, we're going to sing the first, second, and last stanza together. You can remain seated for this song on that first together.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child and forever.
Listen carefully, we have a few announcements for you, and our schedule today, 5:30, is our Christian growth class, and we meet down in the conference room, which is right across from our nursery downstairs. And tonight's lesson, we're going to talk about what the Bible says about tongues and healing, speaking in tongues and healing, and what does the Bible teach about that? And so we ought to learn that and understand that. And so that'll be our lesson tonight at 5:30. Then 6:30, we'll be right back here in the auditorium for our evening service. And tonight, Lord willing, I'm going to talk to you about four imperatives of communication. Four imperatives of communication. The number one problem we have in our relationships, and particularly our relationships at home, is communication. not understanding what somebody said or taking it the wrong way. And so we'll give some help there on four imperatives for communication tonight during our service this evening, all right? Now, next Sunday is Old-Fashioned Sunday, all right? And so we'll have some old-fashioned decorations here, and we want you to dress the part, okay? So get your old-fashioned clothes out. And now, old-fashioned doesn't mean your 1970s leisure suit or something, you know. This is, we're going back further than that, okay? And get the old-fashioned clothes, and we are an old-fashioned Baptist church. We make no apology for that. But we do look the part once a year, and so get opportunity to do that. And we're just putting our stamp of approval on the old-time religion. And I think that's what our country still needs. And so we are going to have a great time together next Sunday. Come be with us. You'll enjoy it. And afterwards, we'll have a dinner on the grounds and potluck out in the fellowship hall there. You can sign up for that on the table downstairs and put down what you're bringing and such. And we'd love to have everybody stay and enjoy the meal with us next week as well. Okay? And then on Monday night, the 19th, the ladies are going to have their ladies' night out. And let's see. It's called Harvest Time. It's going to be at 6:30 Monday evening. Bring a harvest-themed snack, pumpkin, apple, or spices. You can sign up in the foyer. You're going to be making mini, M-I-N-I, mini baskets filled with candy for the nursing home ministry. And also, volunteer-wise, if you want to, you can bring a make-and-take T-shirt necklace. Some of the samples are down there on the table. You can see what they look like, and amazing. You just have to bring an old T-shirt. You don't mind getting cut up, and you can see what that looks like when you look down at the table there. If you'll bring the T-shirt and a good pair of scissors, then you'll be ready to go on that. All right, it'll be a great evening of fellowship and fun, and you'll get a challenge from the Word of God. 6:30 to about 8:30, Monday night, October 19th, for the ladies' night out. All right, and that'll be right over in the fellowship hall. All righty. Well, let's take a minute and let's welcome our guests that are with us in the service today. If you're visiting this morning and you're not a member here at Bible Baptist Church, love to meet you. Find out who you are and where you're from. Anybody here today for the first time, just put your hand up in the air right over here. Okay? Tell us who you are and where you're from. Okay. Well, great. Delighted you came today, Ricky. Thank you so much. And who's with you there? Who's Cassidy, thank you for being here. That's great. Glad you're here today. Thanks for coming. All right. Anyone else here today? See some second timers, and good to have you. If you'll take just a moment and fill out the welcome card, we appreciate you doing that. A little bit, we have the offering, and just drop that in the plate as it goes by. Keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. We're glad you're here this morning. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we?
Foundation stable, I go to the rock, I know that's it.
246, 246. I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Let's sing that verse together. On that first, I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. So praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled. For faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me send by faith on heaven's stable land, the higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher. While we sing that last together, let's have the children go ahead and be dismissed to junior church. On that last together, I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me unto higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me send my faith on heaven. Singing this morning. Let's turn back to number 91, if you would. 91, what a day, what a glorious day that will be. Let's all stand together as we sing, what a day that will be. 91, on that first all together. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. such a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear. Let's sing that last together. There'll be no sorrow there, then burdens to bear. No more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day. Saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be.
Is that going to be a glorious day? Amen. Let's sing that chorus one more time without the instruments. What a day that will be when
great singing. Be seated if you will. Man, if that doesn't get you excited, nothing will, brother. Tell you, wonderful. What a day that'll be. And this is a great time of year because the windows are open and I hope they hear it in the neighborhood. Amen. What a day that'll be. That's great. Good singing this morning. All right. Ready to receive the Lord's tithe and our offering this morning? Give as God has blessed and prospered you today, all right? Let's pray, and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering today. I have Brother Abrams lead us in our prayer.
Let's pray. Lord, Heavenly Father, we come to you today in a somber manner, and we only can stand in awe of your creation, Lord. How can we look up into the stars last night and anyone stand and say there is no God? How could it be? What an awesome sight and what an awesome thing it is to be in your world, Lord. And we look forward to your coming, to your coming again, Lord. And we want to pray for this offering today and bless each gift and each giver. And Lord, keep us on the straight and narrow and give us your blessings. And bless our pastor, and thank you for your word, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Take your Bible this morning, if you would, for our scripture reading. Judges chapter 11, please. Judges chapter 11. Judges 11, and we're going to read verses 1 through 11 of Judges chapter 11. We read the verses responsively. We begin together on verse number 1, then I'll read verse number 2 together on 3, and we'll alternate like that till we end together on verse 11 of Judges chapter 11. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse number 1 of Judges chapter 11. Ready? Now Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty man of valor, and he was the son of a harlot, and Gilead begat Jephthah. And Gilead's wife bare him sons, and his wife's sons grew up, and they thrust out Jephthah, and said unto him, Thou shalt not inherit in our father's house, for thou art the son of a strange woman. Then Jephthah fled from his brethren, and dwelt in the land of Tob. And there were gathered vain men to Jephthah, and went out with him. And it came to pass in the process of time that the children of Ammon made war against Israel. And it was so that when the children of Ammon made war against Israel, the elders of Gilead went to fetch Jephthah out of the land of Tob. And they said unto Jephthah, Come and be our captain, that we may fight with the children of Ammon. And Jephthah said unto the elders of Gilead, Did not ye hate me and expel me out of my father's house? And why are ye come unto me now when ye are in distress? And the elders of Gilead said unto Jephthah, Therefore we turn again to thee now, that thou mayest go with us and fight against the children of Ammon, and be our head over all the inhabitants of Gilead. And Jephthah said unto the elders of Gilead, If ye bring me home again to fight against the children of Ammon, and the Lord deliver them before me, shall I be your head? And the elders of Gilead said unto Jephthah, The Lord be witness between us, if we do not so according to thy words. Then Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and captain over them. And Jephthah uttered all his words before the Lord in Mizpah. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing to the reading of the scripture now this morning. Lord, thank you so much for all what we've heard already today. The music has been wonderful. It's been just a joy to be in the house of God today. And Lord, we're grateful for your goodness to us and for the privilege that's ours to be here today. And Lord, thank you for being here with your presence. And Lord, we feel it in a real way this morning. And I pray that thy spirit would minister to the hearts of people today through your word. Lord, prepare us and make our hearts soft and pliable, as clay would be in the potter's hand, so you could mold us and shape us into vessels of honor for you. And so, Father, bless the special to that end, please. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Trial.
There's been grace for every mile.
and grace, sufficient from his vast supply. Grace to make my heart more tender,
grace to love and pray for sinners.
But there'll be new grace when it's my time to go. Grace not yet discovered, grace not yet uncovered.
Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us, and thank you for your abundant grace. Lord, if it weren't for the grace of God, none of us would be in this room this morning. Lord, by the grace of God, we are what we are. Thank you for your love and your goodness to us. Now, by your grace, speak to our hearts this morning. May your will be accomplished in each one of our lives, please. Help me as I bring the message today and help the people as they listen. And Lord, may your will be done in our midst today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. After the death of Joshua, the Lord, over a period of about 300 years, raised up 12 men and one woman to rule Israel. They were called judges, and they ruled and judged for God, and usually the case would be they deliver Israel out of oppression. Israel had a pattern they went through during these years, largely years of apostasy and immorality and idolatry. And they would get into be oppressed by another country and cry out to God and ask God to deliver. And God would raise up a judge who would deliver them and bring them back to God and out of oppression. The judge would die, and then they would go back into idolatry again. And that cycle would just repeat itself over for 300 years. It's in one of those cycles that we read our story this morning of this one named Jephthah, who was one of those 12 judges. Jephthah's name means God opens, and he was the deliverer that God raised up for Israel. Now, the scripture says that Jephthah was a mighty man of valor. In other words, he was a mighty man of strength, or he was a mighty man of character. He was a mighty man of dignity. He was a mighty man of war. Jephthah, the Gileadite. One night, Jephthah's father had gone into sin. He visited a harlot. And the result of that night, Jephthah was born. Apparently, Jephthah's father made it right with his wife. And they stayed married, and in fact, she bore other children to him and had other sons. When these sons grew up, they knew that Jephthah was only their half-brother. And they didn't want any idea of him being the firstborn to get the inheritance. And so the Bible says that they kicked him out. Jephthah went ahead and left the family. He goes to a land called Tob, T-O-B, Tob. Years go by, and Israel again has gone into idolatry and they're being oppressed by the Ammonites. And they're looking for a deliverer. And when they started thinking about a deliverer, they said, you know, nobody has as much valor and strength and character and courage as Jephthah. And so they go to where Jephthah has fled and ask him to come back and be their deliverer. And Jephthah, again, showing his valor, showing his character, showing his integrity, he comes back. And he does exactly that. He is used by God to deliver Israel. And he delivers them, and he goes on to judge Israel for 6 more years after that. Jephthah was a great man of God. Lest you think I might be exaggerating that, he is listed in Hebrews 11 in the Great Hall of Faith that God had. I mean, he's listed in there where you read about David and Abraham and Isaac and all the heroes, what we say the heroes of the faith. Jephthah's in there. And so he was a mighty man of valor. And what I want to focus with you today is on this statement from verse number 1. It says, he was a mighty man of valor, and he was the son of a harlot. A mighty man of valor, but he was a son of a harlot. If you have Jephthah growing up, who his mom was, he would not have been able to tell you. His brothers and sisters and stepmother and apparently father as well kicked him out of the home. He went to live in a city where he didn't know anyone. And the wrong crowd tried to influence him. The Bible calls them vain men. Vain means empty. So empty-headed men tried to come in and out with him. But the Bible says Jephthah became a mighty man of valor. Jephthah became a man of courage. Jephthah became a mighty man of character. Jephthah became a mighty man of decency. Jephthah became a mighty man of godliness. And can I tell you this morning, it does not matter who your mother or father is. It does not matter where you've come from. It does not matter if you even know who your father or mother are. It doesn't matter this morning if your family has made you an outcast. It doesn't matter this morning if you're in a strange place with strange people. It does not matter, whatever the circumstance may be, you can still be a mighty man of valor. You can still be a man of character. You can still be a man of godliness and dignity. We have so many people today that make excuses for why they behave the way they do and why they act the way they do. Too many are hiding behind past experiences in their lives or past circumstances in their lives. I've heard people say, well, my dad was an alcoholic, so that's why I'm this way. Or my mother never spent time with me, so that's why I'm always in trouble. Or my family just wasn't very loving, so that's why I'm not very loving. Or my parents moved a lot, so that's why I'm not very secure. Or, well, my dad never was a churchgoer, so I'm not much of one either. Well, my parents divorced, so I kind of figured I probably would too. You see, Jephthah would tell us it doesn't matter who your mother or father is, that it doesn't matter whether your mother or father did right or didn't do right. It doesn't matter if you even know who they are. You still have a responsibility to live right in the sight of God. You have a responsibility to do what God says is right in His sight. Doesn't matter if your family's loving or not, you be loving. It does not matter if you're, as Jephthah said, my mom was a harlot, my family doesn't want me, I'm going to strange land where I don't know anybody, but I'll tell you what, I'm going to live for God. I'm going to do what's right in God's sight. I'm not hiding behind my harlot mother. I'm not hiding behind the rejection of my family. I'm not hiding behind anything else. I'm going to do what's right in the sight of God. We studied this morning in our Sunday school class Joseph a little bit. Joseph is an amazing story. Joseph was rejected by his family, and his brothers especially, sold into slavery. And as I was meditating on that story this week, I got to thinking, if Joseph was in modern day times, we would have had people trying to explain to him how it's understandable if he didn't turn out right. All the issues that you've got with your brothers and their hatred of you and being rejected by your family and being sold as a slave and in a strange land with no father or mother. Oh, Joseph, the emotional scars will be with you forever. That's what he would have heard in these days. But that's not the Joseph we read about in the Bible. That's not the Joseph that we read about as we look into the account in Genesis. No, Joseph was falsely accused and imprisoned in Egypt. And as we talked about in our Sunday school class this morning, he, not exactly sure how long he was in prison until the butler and the baker, he had dreams and he interpreted their dreams. And then when they came to pass exactly as Joseph said it would happen, and the baker lost his life and the butler, the butler was able to get out. And he says, hey, when I get out, that's okay, Joseph. I'm going to remember you. And guess what the butler did? He forgot about him. For 2 years. 2 more years, Joseph labored in the prison. When he wasn't supposed to be there. And he continued to be faithful. Continued to do and be what God wanted him to be. Joseph, you're sure to have some personality problems. Joseph, you're sure to have some difficulties with low self-esteem by being forgotten so often by so many people. Certainly, you're going to have some psychological issues to work through. And Joseph says, I don't know about all that, but I'm just going to serve God anyway. I'm just going to serve God anyhow. What did he do? He just became the most decent, upright, godly person that Egypt had ever seen. Listen carefully. You're either going to use the circumstances of your life as a stumbling block or a stepping stone. You're either going to use the circumstances of your life as a stumbling block or a stepping stone. Would you look back to the book of Genesis with me, to Genesis chapter 45, please? Genesis chapter 45. Joseph here revealing himself to his brothers. Notice with you, with me in chapter 4 or chapter 45, verse number 4. Joseph said unto his brethren, come near to me, I pray you. And they came near and he said, I am Joseph your brother, whom ye sold into Egypt. Now therefore be not grieved, nor angry with yourselves, that ye sold me hither. For God did send me before you to preserve life. For these 2 years hath the famine been in the land, and yet there are 5 years in which there shall be neither earing or harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve you a posterity in the earth, and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So now it was not you that sent me hither, but God. And he hath made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. Let me ask you a question. Who sold Joseph into Egypt? God did. Oh, they thought it was them. They thought they had done the deed. But Joseph said, hey, I understand what's going on. God did all that. Who put Joseph in prison in Egypt? God did. Hey, he never would have met the butler and the baker. He never would have interpreted their dream. He never would have had access to Pharaoh. And all that was done because of what God did. I don't know what's going on in your life, but let me help you with something. Nobody's had an ideal past. Nobody's had the storybook life. At least I've never met one yet. Everybody's had difficulties they go through. Everybody has trials you go through. Everybody has things in their life that you look back and say, man, I wish that never would have happened. But guess what? It happened. Now, you're going to live the rest of your life saying, oh, man, because that happened, I'm going to be angry. Because that happened, I'm going to be mad. Because that happened, I'm going to not be able to do this. Because that happened, I'm not going to be able to. And we start making excuses. You're letting it be a stumbling block instead of it being a stepping stone. Hey, who's in control anyway? Who's in control anyway? Joseph came to understand that. Go over to Genesis chapter 50, will you please? Genesis chapter 50. In Genesis, how many of you know Romans 8:28? Yeah. All things work together for good, for we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. All right? There's a Romans 8:28 in the Old Testament, and it's Genesis 50 and verse 20. And this is where Joseph talks to his brothers, and here's what he says. But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive. You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. And God used it for good. Now, before he could say verse 20, he had to come to verse 19. What's verse 19 say? Joseph said unto him, fear not, for am I in the place of God. You never get to say God will work all things together for good. You could mean it for evil, but God will mean it for good. If you can't say, I'm not in the place of God. You know why you look at the past things in your life and you say, well, this happened to me or that happened to me, so that's why I'm this way and that's why I have these issues and that's why I can't do it. You know what you're doing? You're being in the place of God. You're determining what's happened to you and what's going to take place because you're picturing all that it's been a bad thing and this is the result and this is what I got to live with and this just be the way I am because you're in the place of God. You get out of the way and let God be God. And let him say, God, you're in control of my life. And he is. I'm not saying that there weren't some evil things that happened to you when you were in your past life. Sure. And there are a lot of people in this room that you look at and you think, man, if I just had their background, if I just grew up the way they grew up, boy, I'd be serving God like they are. You don't have any idea where they've come from. You don't know what they've been through in their life. In some cases, I have to bite my tongue because I know they've been through much worse than what you've been through, but they're serving God anyway, and they're loving God, and they're loving people, and they're doing what God wants them to do, and I know they've had far worse experiences than what you've been through. But I can't tell you that. Is it a stepping stone or a stumbling block? Who's in charge anyway? Who's in control anyway? Are you in the place of God? Are you determining? Well, because that happened, that's bad, and so therefore I'm going to be this way or I'm going to be that way. Well, then you're in God's place. You need to say, you know what? All these things happen, but God is working in my life. And I either can look at it that God will mean it for good, even though others may have meant it for evil. Or I'll just take it and make it evil. In my life. How many of you are familiar with Patch the Pirate? Let me see your hand. Yeah, pretty much, about three quarters. Writer of many children's songs through the years. Oh, I'm guessing what now? Probably close to 40 years now. The Patch the Pirate is a man named Ron Hamilton. Ron Hamilton and also writes other cantatas. We've done cantatas and such. In fact, I think we might be doing one at Christmas. That's one of his. And he had eye pain one day and went to the ophthalmologist to get it checked out. And they found out he had a tumor in his eye. And And he went to have surgery at Emory University in Atlanta, Georgia. Not knowing that when he went into surgery, whether he would come out with his eye or not come out with his eye. Depending on the cancer of the tumor, whether it was cancerous or not. And as the story unfolded and he came into the recovery, he understood that they had to remove his eye. Several weeks after that, he led music in the church, and he came out and he had to wear a patch over his eye. And my little child came up and said, "You asked what that was on his eye," and he said, "It's a patch." He goes, "Well," little boy said, "you look like a pirate." And he chuckled. He said, "Well, I guess I am." He said, "I guess I'm Patch the Pirate." And you know what that did? That launched an entire ministry of gospel songs for children that our kids grew up on. And some of the grandkids are still listening to. And other kids are still growing up on. Over 40 years of providing gospel music to churches. You see, it could have been a stumbling block. God, why me? God, why do I lose an eye? Why do I have to go through this? This can't be a good thing. Why'd you let this happen to me? No, he used it as a stepping stone and allowed God to work it together for good. Fanny Crosby was no different. You leaf through your songbook, you'll find many songs written by Fanny Crosby. She wrote over 3,000. Fanny Crosby, when she was just 6 months of age, was blinded by the mistake of a doctor trying to treat some sinus condition or something. He put, some hot packs of something on her eyes and literally burned her eyes. And she was blinded. Talk about someone who could have been bitter. She had no control over that. She's a 6-month-old infant. Fanny Crosby went on to write thousands of gospel songs. And was able to say, "I thank God that I was blind." She said, "I thank God that happened to me." She said, "You know something? The first face I'll ever see will be the face of Jesus." Isn't that amazing? That's what we're talking about. Who's in control anyway? Is it God or is it you? Daniel's another one I think of who was taken captive as a teenager. Taken from Jerusalem into the land of Babylon, some 500 miles from home. Now, 500 miles to us doesn't seem that far in these days. But in those days, 500 miles, you ride a camel 500 miles, buddy, you know it, all right? That hump isn't real comfy. And I'm sure Daniel, and by the way, as a teenager, from what all accounts would be, I wonder if anybody ever told Daniel, "Come on, Daniel, if you don't live for God, everybody's going to understand." Because look, McLean, the pressure's on, and it wasn't just the people in Babylon applying the pressure; the other captives were going along with it. Come on, Daniel, what's wrong with you? Don't be a fanatic. Don't be that way, Daniel. Come on, join the club. When in Babylon, do as the Babylonians do. I'm sure there was some pretty intense pressure to follow the false gods and the lifestyle of the Babylonians. But when you read the book of Daniel, it says Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the king's meat or the king's drink. You see, Daniel purposed in his heart that whatever took place in Babylon, it wasn't going to change who he was, what he believed and how he was going to live. It was not going to impact him. And that's exactly what every one of us have to do. We have things in our lives that we look back on and say, man, I wish that wasn't in my life. I wish that hadn't happened. But listen, God had that happen in my life. God allowed that to take place in my life. Now I'm going to purpose in my heart that that is going to work for my good and not for my evil. What were you going to determine? Mother or no mother? Father or no father? Broken home or no broken home? Drinking in the home or no drinking in the home? Good childhood or horrible childhood? You have to purpose in your heart, you are going to serve God. Purpose in your heart to be faithful to the Lord. Purpose in your heart to be what you ought to be. Nobody has a perfect past. Nobody has a perfect past. But those who serve God say, what has happened, and I will not use it as an excuse to be less than I ought to be for God. Doesn't matter what took place, I'm living for God. Does not matter who hurt me, I'm living for God. Does not matter where I came from, I'm living for God. Does not matter who rejected me, I'm living for God. Doesn't matter about my past mistakes, I'm living for God. I'll not hide behind any excuses any longer. I will live for God. I will be what I ought to be. The Bible says in the book of Romans, so then every one of us will give account of himself to God. Every one of us will give account of himself to God. And you're not going to stand before God and blame somebody else for why you didn't live the way you ought to live. I think if we stood before God and say, yeah, but God, my parents were this way, or I didn't know this, or my mom did this, or my dad did this, or this happened to me when I was younger, I think God may say, hey, Jephthah, come here. Hey, Daniel, come here. Hey, Joseph, come here. Hey, David, come here. Go through the Bible. Men who just purpose in their heart to live for God, regardless of the circumstances or the past. Why don't you be a Jephthah? Why don't you be a Daniel? Why don't you be a Joseph? Why don't you be a Ron Hamilton? Why don't you be a Fanny Crosby? You see, God desires to use and bless you. God desires to use and bless you. Don't sit and think, yeah, God blessed those people and God used them. That was good for them, but God's not going to do that with me. He will absolutely do it with you. God is no respecter of persons. And He desires to use you for His glory. And He loves to take people that the world would say, man, with their background and all the things that have happened to them, man, they shouldn't be doing anything in life. They ought to be on pills. They ought to be put in an institution somewhere and just chill out, man. And they'll say, man, how does God use somebody like that? Because God loves to use the off-scouring of the world. God loves to use things the world would throw away and say, I'll do great things with them. If you will be what you ought to be, God will give you the opportunity to do what you ought to do. If you'll be what you ought to be, God will give you the opportunity to do what you ought to do. But I'm talking to people today who you're not being what you ought to be because there's something that took place or some things that took place and you haven't ever said, you know what? God, you let it happen. You allowed it to be in my life. Use it for my good. I will not use it as an excuse. Give it to God. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. And move forward for God. Purpose in your heart that you're going to live for Him. And be what you ought to be. Background, circumstances, our environment are not excuses not to serve God. I said background, circumstances, or environment are no excuses not to serve God. They're not. Jephthah. Jephthah, a mighty man of valor. But his mother was a harlot. Let's be Jephthahs. Let's be Jephthahs. Nobody has a perfect past. They're just those who said, like Joseph, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. They're those like Daniel who said, I'll purpose in my heart. I'll not defile myself. I'm not going to use the fact I got taken over in captivity. I'm away from my parents. I'm away from everybody else. I won't use the excuse, everybody else is doing it. I won't use those excuses. I realize I'll give account of myself to God one day. And I can't hide behind anything else. I'll be a Jephthah. I'll be a mighty man, a mighty woman of valor. Even though I have things in my life that hurt me, that weren't pleasant to go through. None of those things Joseph went through were pleasant, but they were of God. See, we get the idea that because God loves us, we'll never have to go through anything unpleasant. We think like Peter, pain and suffering can never be part of God's plan. But it is. It is. Let me ask you a question. Was pain and suffering part of God's plan for His Son? Yes, it was. Oh, I'm glad Jesus suffered and I'm glad He died on the cross. I'm glad He paid for my sin debt, aren't you? But God, don't make me have any pain in my life. God, don't make me have any suffering in my life. As soon as we get pain or we suffer, God, take this from me. Take it away. And God says, I'm trying to teach you something. I brought that sickness, I brought that pain to you to teach you some things. Let God teach you. I think that song we sing occasionally, More Love to Thee, O Christ. One of those verses says, send grief and pain. Give me some sorrow and pain. Who prays for that? We don't like that. But somebody understood what God uses in our lives to mold us and shape us into vessels of honor for Him. Be a Jephthah this morning. Jephthah was a mighty man of valor, but his mother was a harlot. What is it in your life that's holding you back? What is it in your life that you point to and say, well, that right there, that's what messed me up. That's why I'm not doing this. That's why I'm angry. That's why I'm mad. That's why I'm frustrated. That's why I do this. That's why I'm not serving God. You know people who are out of church today because of that. Why don't you give that to God today? Why don't you say, today, October 11th, 2015, I'll be a Jephthah. We had a wonderful night last night at the Mannings. Michelle's here this morning, and Shane had to work on an emergency situation. And they gave such a sweet testimony last night of the church family and how much that means to them. Some of you got to meet their daughter, Megan, and her husband, Scott. They were there last night with the grandbaby. Didn't get to meet their 18-year-old son 3 years ago. He went to heaven 3 years ago. Didn't get to meet him. He's with Jesus. We talked about it riding back a little bit. I rode with Shane. I told him a little bit about what I was going to preach this morning, because I knew he wasn't going to be here. And said, you know, there's a lot of people when they go through what you and Michelle went through, would have gotten mad at God. Used it as a case against God. He goes, well, he said, I can't tell you, there aren't some times I feel that way. And by the way, it was a great testimony to you, Michelle. He said, but Michelle's so strong and just keeps her eyes on the Lord and tells us we ought to be thankful that we had 18 years. Some people don't get that many years. Some people, in fact, some people want children and can't even have them. How thankful we are that God gave us the children we gave us to. And what a sweet spirit they both have. But many of you didn't even know what they've been through. You don't know that heartache. I can't imagine losing a child. I don't know what that would be like. What a testimony of God's grace that they are. And how they're allowing God to use it in their life for good. And by the way, it was through that Shane came to know the Lord as a Savior. See? God knows what He's doing. And I guarantee you, their son in heaven said, well, Jesus, if that's what it took for Dad to get saved, praise the Lord. He's thrilled about that. You don't know what God will use that for. But there is a reason. There is a purpose of God why we go through what we go through. So don't get rid of the bitterness. Get rid of being angry about it. And say, God, You are in control. My times are in Your hands. And I'm going to serve You. I'm going to live for You. I'm going to be what I ought to be for You. Be a Jephthah. Jephthah was a mighty man of valor. But his mother was a harlot. Let's pray, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank You, Lord, for the attention of everyone today. And Father, I pray that You've spoken to hearts this morning. I pray, Holy Spirit, that You have ministered to Your people today. Lord, I pray there's some people this morning that will be set free. They'll bring this burden to the Lord and leave it there. Not be bound by it anymore. Not use it as an excuse anymore. Not be able to hide behind it anymore. But they'll be Joseph, and they'll be Jephthah, and they'll be like Daniel, and they'll be like so many others we could talk about this morning. You allow all of these things to come into our life to make us what You desire us to be. Help us not resist what you have done and what You are doing in our lives. It all molds us and shapes us into the vessel that You want us to be. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Let me ask first of all this morning, I wonder how many folks in the room today would say, Pastor, if I died this morning, I know that I'd go to heaven. There's a time in my life when I knew as I was a sinner and I knew that I needed a Savior and I knew Jesus was the Savior I needed. And Pastor, I've called on the Lord Jesus and from my heart I've trusted Him as my Savior. And I know that I'm saved this morning. Would you put your hand up for a moment, please, so I could see it? Just say, here's my testimony. I know that I'm saved. All right, you may put it down. So somebody here today would say, Pastor, I don't know for sure. If I died, I'd go to heaven. I don't know that I've ever called on the Lord and asked Him to save me. Pastor, pray for me this morning. Would you slip your hand up? All right. The message was to believers today. I wonder how many believers here this morning would say, Preacher, the Spirit of God dealt with my heart today. I've got some things that have taken place like Joseph did, like Jephthah did. And it's bothered me. Hindering me from being what God wants me to be. Preacher, I need to give them to God today. I'm going to be a Jephthah. I'm going to be a mighty man of valor, a mighty woman of valor. How many believers here today would say, Preacher, God spoke to my heart. Pray for me this morning. Will you slip your hand up, Christian? Yes. 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 Amen. Thank you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray, and we're going to have an invitation. In the Old Testament, the place where people met God was at an altar. They would always build an altar to meet with God. That's what this front is, and a step here where we kneel down, it's the altar. That's where you meet with God. Why don't you come this morning and take whatever it is from the past, lay it at the altar and say, God, they meant it for evil, but you meant it for good. And I'm going to allow you to use it for good in my life, not for evil. And take your burden to the Lord this morning and leave it there. And walk out today a new person. Purposed in your heart to live for God. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts this morning. Lord, I pray for each individual that lifted their hand and even maybe some that didn't, but you have spoken to their heart. That, Lord, these next few minutes this morning, you have your will and way in our lives. Lord, you've spoken to us. I pray that each individual would obey and do what you're telling them to do in their heart. They'd bow the knee at an altar and let you, as a loving Heavenly Father, remind them that you are in control and have been in control of their life. And may they give it to you this morning. Please bless this invitation. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to him this morning. Will you please? That's right.
God never moves without purpose or plan.
Amen.
When trying his servant and molding a man, give thanks to the Lord, though your testing seems long. In darkness he giveth a song. Oh, rejoice.
Ron Hamilton wrote this song.
He makes
once he realized he lost his eye.
He knoweth the end of each
think of the words that he's singing.
That I take, for when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold. I could not see through the shadows ahead, so I looked at the cross of my Savior instead. I bowed to the will of the Master that day. Then peace came and tears fled away. Oh, rejoice in the Lord. He makes no mistake. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. For when I am tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold. Now I can see testing comes from above. God strengthens his children and purges in love. My Father knows best, and I trust in his care. Through purging, more fruit I will bear.
Oh, rejoice in the Lord. He makes no mistakes. He knoweth the end of each path that I take. tried and purified, I shall come forth as gold.
Father, I pray that as we're tried and purified, we'll come forth as gold. That, Lord, we'll trust in your care, and that through purging, more fruit we will bear. Lord, thank you for the truth, and thank you, Lord, for those who've gone before us and have shown us that they lived for God and they served you and they did what they should have done. They were what they should be, even though their life had some very, very difficult things in it. Most of us can relate to that. Most people in this room could come up with something as to why they shouldn't serve God. And we'd be wrong. We know that you love us, and we know that you are working all things together for good when we love you with a call according to your purpose. I pray, Lord, that we'll leave these doors today and leave this room and say, I'll be a Jephthah. I'm going to be a mighty man or mighty woman of valor, of integrity, of decency, of honesty, of godliness. Even though I've got some things in my past that I wish hadn't have happened to me. We can't go back and make anything over, but we can start today and make a brand new ending. And I pray we do that. Thank you for everyone's attention today. Dismiss us now with your care and give us a good afternoon. Prepare us for what you have for us in the service this evening. It's in Christ's name that we ask it. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Let's sing that together.